I am from IIT Madras. I was in the engineering physics program for 4 years, and now I have graduated from there. Now I work at Adobe, and I had worked as a part of Adobe for a research internship, and from there they gave me a role, and then I joined at Adobe. So right now I'm working with them. Just a brief introduction. Okay, so as all of you are newly just finished JE and are now in the counseling part of it, right?
Hi Arvind, could you up your volume a bit? Because I think you're not audible to many.
Okay. So what I was saying was, every one of you over here just finished JE and is now in the counseling part of the process, right?
Yes.
Okay. So I made a presentation for you guys based on similar doubts I had when I was in your position. So the structure that I'll be following when I'm giving the presentation is like the whole program overview, which would consist of the course structure. So for now, I'm only looking at how the IIT Madras Engineering Physics course structure is. It doesn't vary that much, but certain other institutes have their own way of, there is differences between different institutes for engineering physics. So I'll be sticking to how IIT Madras does it. And then I'll be going on to the topics of interest that people may have or develop during the course. And then I would then go on to talk about the internships and the opportunities you will have during this program. And then finally, the exit part of it, like after graduation, what happens? That is the jobs or the admissions, like what happens if you want? How do you go about going for further studies? So starting with the course structure, I would like to straight away dig into the details and go to this page so that I don't know if you guys have seen it or not, but let's discuss the whole curriculum over here. So can anyone just, I have most of you gone through this. Can anyone just put it in the chat if people have gone through the curriculum before? So if you have viewed, you would already notice that the first two semesters, that is over here, right? First two semesters are very general. That is, they want to again brush up whatever you learned at 11th, 12th and build on top of what you have already learned. That is Math 1, Physics 1, Chemistry 1 would just be slightly advanced compared to what you have learned in JE. That is some multivariate calculus, whatnot. Whatever you would need later on in your courses, whichever engineering you choose. And then over here, if you see PH1080, it is a slight taste of theoretical physics that you'll get in your first semester. It's a very interesting course that you'll have. Everything else is like, first year is very general. You learn all the general topics and then you move on to your specific department electives. So first year, you have Math 1, Physics 1, Chemistry 1. Introduction to programming is like compulsory so that you learn your basic coding, that is C, C++, whatever. And then, yeah, workshop, life skills, that is in any college. Similarly, second semester is also like this, Math 2, Physics 2, Chemistry. So over here, again, you will see that a slight taste of what you might study in engineering physics would again be here, that is in digital systems. That is in the electrical department of IIT Madras and signals and systems. It's a very mathematical and electric-oriented course, which is just another start to the electric department again, your first year. Now, the way engineering physics goes is, it sort of has a trend of going from physics, then elect, physics, in odd and even semester. So over here, you see electric circuits and networks in the third semester, introduction to mathematical physics and electromagnetics. Two of them are physics courses and one is an elect course. Electric circuits is again your Kirchhoff's law, but again, slightly advanced, right? And then some four, you have your solid state devices, digital signal processing, analog systems. So again, now you see that it's a more elect department oriented semester. So now once you're done with, so this is your second year. Second year, first part is elect physics heavy. And then second part of the second year is more towards the electrical department side, right? And now is the best part. Once you have finished your 2 years, you see over here, there are many electives, right? So by second year, the departments you would have learned certain number of courses, right? These courses serve as prerequisites, right? Which are required for advanced courses that you'll do much later. So here you have quantum mechanics and then PP lab, HS elective, professional electives. Electives are nothing but like it's a placeholder where you get to choose what kind of a course you want from a set of courses that are offered, like in any other university. So these are degrees of freedom. This is where you discover what you like and not like, right? By third year, generally people aim for that. Like third year, they find out what they like, what they don't like, where they, rough idea of where they want to go. Some people figure it out, some people not. They have enough time after that as well. But that is just a general trend and what is expected of a student, right? So third year, yes, semester 5, first part of third year. And then semester 6, that is the second part of third year, we again have a lot of electives. And then two courses again, which are compulsory. Concepts of condensed matter physics and statistical physics. Right. So then electives, right? One good thing about engineering physics is that professional electives and free electives are very free. That is, you get a lot of choices. Free electives are that you can take a course from any department you want. And professional electives are you can take a course from either physics department or elect department. Various other programs are restricted to just one particular department. We have a choice of doing courses from two departments when it comes to professional electives. Right. So now this marks the end of third year. After your third year, you have your third year internship. And then you move on to SEM 7. So again, over here, you just see that it's full of just electives. Nothing is fixed. Nothing at all is fixed. You can just, now you have figured out what you like, and then you keep choosing whatever courses you choose based on your liking from whatever is being offered. Similarly, SEM 8 is also full of electives. So people who are, who still have, if you would have noticed from SEM 5 itself, there's a lot of room for choice. That is, if you like a certain topic, you can explore it. If you're still exploring, you can keep trying out new things. And engineering physics really gives you room for exploring. You have a lot of departments at your disposal, and you can jump around from one end to another anytime you want. One time you feel like one semester you are more into physics, or another semester you are really into hardware, electrical. And even if you like start liking other departments like computer science or biology, anything, right? You can just explore them through your free electives, right? So, yeah. That covers the curriculum side of things. Does anyone have any particular things to ask about the course structure? We can just clear it up. Just address like 2-3 questions. So that question, I would have to look at what the curriculum is for IIT Guwahati. But the best way to judge a course when it comes to course structure is to go to their website and do a one loop, like a mapping of how different they are, right, in their structure. But that, again, a course structure would again just entail fixed courses and electives. So you have to count the number of electives you might have in terms of credits to see how free, how rigid or how free the course is. So I think that answers your question. Okay, student exchange program. Student exchange program is open to everyone. It is, the way it works is that you should be able to map your requirement, like course requirements. That is, in a semester, if you have, let's say, condensed matter physics and solid state devices, where whichever university you are going to, if they offer those two, then you can go over there. And the way they give you the university is based on your CGPA. It's a competition based on your CGPA. Does it come under electrical department? No, not really. Engineering physics is part of both departments, electrical and physics. Is it very similar to electrical? No, not really. As I said, some semesters are physics heavy and then some are electrical heavy. So it's a mix of both. So what kind of job do you get after the degree? Okay, that I'll address towards the end. Right now, I'm just talking about questions regarding the course. How much of abstract physics will be? We have like quantum mechanics. So quantum mechanics is the start, right? And abstract, I don't know what you mean by abstract physics, but theoretical physics is like that. Like right from the beginning, the thermodynamics will also have certain interesting topics like black hole thermodynamics. So again, it's not a very visual topic. It's mostly differential equations and stuff like that. So yeah. The core companies, again, job, I'll discuss that in the end. But yeah, quantum mechanics, once you do that, you can do a lot of other courses related to it. It's like a prerequisite. Mm. So physics, some courses are very theory based, some are very relevant for your experimental side as well. Our engineering students actually specialize in electrical considered by electrical engineering. Yes. So many, two, whoever wanted to get into electrical companies got in. Like Texas Instruments took two people for digital design, analog design. So if you do enough courses in the electrical department, I showed you a lot of electives, right? If you use them up for doing many electrical courses, you measure up to the electrical department students. Okay, and now I'm going to address how is engineering physics different from pure science physics, right? Pure science physics is like you're mainly doing the non-engineering part of it. That is the pure science part. Pure physics is just pure physics, right? Engineering physics has its own engineering part of things. You do a lot of things in the engineering, electrical engineering lab. It's more practical. It helps you go in and out of physics, right? It's not just physics. You have many other courses, as you can see in the curriculum. Are there courses on quantum computing? Yes, there are many courses, and now they have very good support faculty in that field. They even have a specialization degree for quantum sciences in IIT, which you can take if you're interested. So you just have to stay for one more year and you can work on quantum sciences. Any other questions? Okay, then I'll move on to the next section. So I've discussed the course structure. Am I audible? Or is it feeble again?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. So yeah, I would now like to talk about the topics of interest people generally develop, like the students of engineering physics, what they develop. So there is a trend of many people getting into quantum computing because engineering physics gives you a good blend of the hardware part, that is the electrical engineering part, and also the physics behind it, right? So that's what the requirement of a quantum computer like scientist would be. They have to know both side of things, and engineering physics really comes in handy over there. So we are very well suited for that. Theoretical and experimental physics. Again, we do a lot of physics courses, so if you develop an interest in that, you could follow that path. Analog and digital design. We have the in second year itself, by first year and second year itself, you would have an introduction, the ancestry courses that you need for this. You would have done them. And if you like them, you can follow that path. There are many specialization courses that you can do as a part of your elective. Signal processing, that is in your second year, you have signals and systems. If you like that, you can go on to do digital signal processing and many other signal processing courses. We have good faculty for that. And well, like there are many other streams also that you can follow, right? If halfway you think that this is physics is not what you expected, because one major trend that happens is people, JEE physics is different from the actual physics. JEE physics has many different aspects like mechanics, that is like mechanical engineering. Then you have your electrodynamics, electrical part, which is sort of related to electrical engineering. And then there are like many other things. So it's more of an engineering type, but theoretical physics is very different from the physics you study in your 11th, 12th. So it may or may not be a cup of tea, but you have to explore it on your own. There is no saying that you will or will not like it. So once you don't decide, like you like math, and then data science, data analytics becomes very interesting because it has a very mathematical and challenging aspect and very computational as well. Some people also go into ML software, which is sort of what I got into. It got a mix of, I worked on quantum computing, quantum machine learning, and then I worked on quantum cryptography, and then I moved on to working towards data science research. So it was a blend of all these things, right? And there'll be certain research internships that you might get where you get to truly explore the topic, and it's not just from courses. So yes, these are some topics. And then there are also so you can always also go into business and management topics, right? There's a MBA school in IIT Madras itself. So whichever electives, I talked about three electives, right? You can even take courses from the management department. That is called DOMS. DOMS department in IIT Madras gives you all kinds of management studies courses. So if you develop an interest in that as well, you can explore it through your electives. So these are some of the general topics people go into. Now I would like to talk about internships and opportunities. So this is a very essential part of your journey at any college, any university, because this is the part where you explore outside of your university, not within your class, but outside in the real world, what's happening, right? So get an idea of what is truly relevant, what kind of skills, what kind of practical skills you develop. So IIT Madras, after second year in AP, is engineering physics. Many companies come and open up for us, right? From like software, from ML, from business roles to machine learning roles, from electrical engineering roles, many of them, right? And then if you are interested in physics, it is the other way around, where you go for within India or international research internship programs, right? There are many programs that are there, international programs, right? And since you are in an IIT, there is it is easier for us to apply there, right? So in your second year internship or after your third year internship, you either go into industrial interns, where you can either work on research or an industrial intern, or you can work on international research internships, which are purely academic or experimental. And there is no strict requirement for an industrial research intern when it comes to engineering physics. Even if there is a requirement for a national, like within India internship, that is compulsory for every student. But for engineering physics, it need not be an industrial intern. It can also be a research intern within India. Yeah, and apart from vacations, you can also work on projects along this during the semester with the professors or any faculty. If you see that they are working on something interesting, you can just go to them and request them to work with them. And then you can also work on independent projects and also startups within the college. There are many facilities where you will be funded for a good idea. You will get a team and you can work together. So these are the opportunities that you get in a university. And in engineering physics, as I explained, if you are on the industrial side of it, of things, you can have campus placements for internships. And if you are interested in academic or research internships, there are many international programs that are there. So do you guys have any doubts based on this section? From which year can we go for internships? So there is no particular year after which you can go for internships. It's just that you have to have the right amount of time. That is, like, internships just don't get over in 2 or 3 weeks. So winter vacations or summer vacations are when people usually go for internships. So if you're like in your first year, you might not get that many opportunities because you haven't learned enough for you to be useful to someone, but you can still try. But mainly people get good internships or good opportunities after second year summer or second year winter, starting then. Yeah. How much free time do you get when studying EP? Oh yeah, I mean, I believe that the course structure, like first and second year, is kind of hectic because you have a lot of workload when it comes to coursework, but that's just in the class. So your day would look something like 9 to 5, you would have labs and classes and stuff like that. But after 5 o'clock, you have time to explore and like do whatever you want, like be part of teams, various teams like sports teams or organizing teams or the team that is organizing this particular call, anything. Like you will have time for all of that. No worries. It's not hectic at all. Will its demand in India increase in future? Demand of what, Sonia? What do you mean by demand? Its demand. You can unmute yourself. Hello? Okay. I am audible, right?
Yeah. I think we can move on to the next question.
Okay. Will we have opportunities to pursue other fields like CS? Definitely. I am doing CS right now. So it's... I did CS courses as well when I was in AP. It's not at all rigorous. Like, that's what I said, right? If you have electives, you have time. And depending on how much time you can dedicate, you can manage. But it's totally manageable. Is EP a good option if you have interest in both programming and physics and integrating the two fields? Yes, definitely. As I said, right, I worked on quantum machine learning. So that, again, was a confluence of both. How does the future of quantum computing look like? I mean, I'm not at all the guy to answer that. But in terms of learning, as a student, it is definitely a very interesting topic to learn. I enjoyed learning it. It's very interesting. And yeah, the future, I mean, it could be anything. It has its own time, but definitely you have, if you study it and you understand, like you like it, then you can pursue it. Which is the best branch to enter the field of computing? I mean, I would say it's engineering physics, because what happens is if you are in computer science or electrical engineering, it's a bit tough for them to go out of their way and do physics courses, because after 2 years of just doing electrical and computer science, they become very out of touch when it comes to physics. So they sort of become reluctant to put in all that effort. So definitely engineering physics would be the best branch for to get into quantum computing, or even just physics. Do you have an approach to companies, research engineering, or on your own, or does the college connect you with them? So research institutes, the college won't connect you with them, but definitely you can ask professors for recommendations and they will help you out. Companies, yes. Companies, the internship placements that happen in the institute helps you. They connect you with the companies. If you take electives from other department, how can we understand it? So that's not how it works. Like if you take electives from departments, there are levels to it. If you, let's say, you're working on something like operation research. So there is a first basic course that you have to take, right? It's called the fundamentals of operation research. After that, only can you do another advanced course in the same topic, which is advanced operation research. So there are certain, if a course is tough and you can't understand it, there will be a prerequisite to it, which you have to do it. Are the international research internship opportunities in CMS for? They differ, and it's up for them to decide, right? Like if there is a international research program, they just look at what projects you have done, what kind of research experience you have in the topic or the project you are applying for. Let's take the topic of signal processing. An electrical student would have studied it, but if you have studied and also worked on a project regarding that topic, then when you apply for that internship, you have a better chance of getting in because you have more experience and you have put in more time in trying to understand the topic. So that's how it works. There's no fixed rule that a particular department is favored. If you have the experience in the topic, you will get it. Is it easier to branch into CS via mechanical or EP? So yeah, a branch into CS doesn't matter where you're going in from. It's just a branch change is just based on CGPA after first semester. So it doesn't matter what course, what.
Will it be easier to branch into CS? Like I'm talking after in higher studies, after college.
Sorry. Okay. That's a good question, but then it depends. I mean, the way you apply to CS, right, for higher studies is that you have to do the minimum courses that is required, right? Like data structures or systems or networks and all that. Whoever has those courses done in their transcript and has done research interns or industrial interns regarding computer science, that is ML software related projects, that's how it works. Mechanical, I personally do not know that many people who have gone into it. They mostly, the aspect they go into is robotics from mechanical. If they have a coding interest, they generally go into something like robotics, but there is no such favorable differences. The better question you should ask is which one has more electives. If you have many interests, then you would want to go with a course that has many electives so that you have more room to explore various other courses, right? You don't want a course where all the courses are set for you. Like in a semester, there is no room for like freedom to choose your own course. So I would say like compare the number of electives, and I think it's comparable, or maybe EP has more electives, but I'm not sure about that. You should look into it. Does engineering, physics and IITs have different syllabus? Yes, they have different syllabuses, but the concept is still similar. Only the weightage of electrical and physics varies. So I believe IIT Bombay is more towards the physics side. Like they have more weightage toward physics courses, and Delhi is more towards electrical, I think. For Tensor's team, can you please arrange for a time for mathematical computing? No, it's not in IIT Madras. Okay. Yeah, there is branch change in IIT Madras, yes. in your first semester based on your CGPA. There's a competition all through. Based on that, you get allocated.
Okay, I would like to add to it. Right now, IIT Madras has cancelled branch change since last year because it is online. Mm-hmm. So hopefully once it's back to offline sessions, I guess they will start changes again. But since again, you guys are probably going to join IIT Madras during November or December, and you guys will be having a short semester compared to the normal batches. So probably IIT Madras will cancel branch change this year also. So don't think of branch change as something that you would do once you get into college, if you're going to choose a branch that way. So build your choices wisely, I would suggest. If you're planning to take EP and then move on to CS, and then you get to know that there is no branch change option. So plan things accordingly. But yeah, as he said, like CS field, you could still go on to CS field even if you join EP. So it's not a...
Yeah, definitely. Like if branch change is cancelled, then definitely you shouldn't plan your way around choosing a department based on branch change because it is not available as an option. I would say do not make a choice based on branch change at all. Choose whichever branch you're getting, like whatever choices you have, which one you would like the most or be comfortable with. You shouldn't regret your choice later by when you end up in a college, because branch is important. How many electives can we choose? Is it limited? Is it manageable? Can we take multiple electives? So electives is part of your curriculum. And you can overextend if you want to extend take extra courses and extend your credits. That is also doable. But electives is fixed. Like as you saw in the curriculum, there's a fixed number of electives. Is EP a research-oriented subject? EP is not a subject, it's a program. And research-oriented, I mean, the physics part is mainly theoretical and sort of some experimental side physics. And electrical side of things is somewhat very much engineering. So it's the program is not research oriented, but it has prospects which are very much favorable for a research, a career in research, if you want to, that is. Please pardon, answer to my question. I answered, right? I just now answered that question.
Yeah, I guess he didn't clearly get the answer. He wants you to repeat it.
Okay. So what I said was, is that in the curriculum, the number of electives is fixed. The credits allotted for electives is fixed. So in a semester, right, if you have three free electives and one professional elective, that means that three free electives you can take from any department, and one professional elective means you can take courses from electrical or physics department, but they are fixed, the number of courses that you can take. How many students are in EP right now? I'm not sure of the number right now, but I think it's in the higher 30s or close to 40, I think. I'm not sure. I can check over here. Is my screen getting shared?
Yeah.
Yeah, so this is the number, 40. Answer is 40. It was much smaller. When I joined, it was 28 students. But I feel like smaller batches are better because you have much more interaction with your professors. The mechanical branch in IIT Madras, I think, has 140 people or something like that. So the classes are so big that the professors wouldn't... I mean, definitely in engineering physics, you get to be on a personal level. Like, you get a lot of attention. You can talk to the professors whenever you want. It's a much smaller, not a much smaller batch, but I think it's an adequate number for better one-to-one interaction with the faculty. The ratio is favorable for better learning.
Yeah, just to clarify, mechanical has about 200 people these days.
Oh, wow. My bad. How to find if I'm interested in EP before joining it? Well, I would suggest like exploring topics that I listed out certain topics, right? like quantum machine learning, quantum computing, or signal processing, electrical engineering, like the core subjects of engineering physics. Just watch some videos about them, right? You can explore the topic on your own, see if you like it or not, and also see if you like something else. That is, if based on your rank, if you're getting some other things, explore them. Watch videos about that program, not generic videos, but watch programs which you're considering. Watch videos about them or read about them, and then make an informed decision. Do not go by what people are just saying, that this has better opportunities or something like that, but rather introspect and watch videos about the programs you are considering. Then ask yourself if you would be interested. There's no clear way of knowing, but that is a step in the right direction, I think. Is the number of free electives limited? Yes. You can check the curriculum to find out, but I think it's adequate. There are a lot of free electives in third year onwards. What are department electives for EPA? Yeah, so department electives means professional electives. P elective, P dot elective in the curriculum means you can choose a course from electrical or physics department. Seat matrix on JOSA says MEC has 215. Okay. While it comes to core job opportunities in electrical, will two people have same knowledge in a particular field from ELEC and have the same opportunity? Okay. So, I didn't really sit for the electrical companies, but from what I know, internship-wise, it was a bit tough. But when it came to placements, when there were a lot of opportunities at hand, they had equal opportunity with the same amount of knowledge. During internships, it is a bit more competitive, but it is still very much achievable. From my batch, whoever was interested in electrical engineering was able to get in. That is Texas Instruments or some other companies might not open for engineering physics, like Samsung and Qualcomm had some issues with certain courses, but I think they would also now open up. I would have to clarify all of that with the current placement core or whatever that may be. But definitely, EP has very good opportunities to go into ELEC as well. How different are mechanical and EP? So they are very different. They are very, very different. I would just leave it at that. It's sort of, I mean, I shouldn't speak for mechanical. If there is anyone from mechanical in tenses, they may speak about mechanical. But I think if you're comparing the both, the physics in EP is more of the research and theoretical side, whereas the physics part of mechanical is more towards, like, I think, fluid dynamics and mechanics, stuff like that, yeah. Okay, I'll show you the topics once more. You can take a screenshot if you want. Or I can send this PPT, but it's very general.
Yeah, probably you could send the PPT and we can post it in the groups to everybody.
Sure, sure.
Yeah.
Did you copy it or take a screenshot so that I can move on? Whoever it was. Nishant, was it fine? Can you just put it in the chat? Yeah. Okay. Can you tell a little about taking minor degree? Okay. So minor degrees, I would give a brief discussion about that. Minor means that if you do three courses under one topic, right? So just to take an example of control systems, if you do signals and systems and control theory, stuff like that, if you have basically three courses under one topic, and these are fixed, like, the Dean of Academics will send a list of courses that if you do, you will be eligible for a minor. That's how it works. And I mean, there is no what minor degree would go best with EPA. And it's not even that relevant. You can just keep doing courses that you are interested in. A minor is just a product of that. It's not that you want to make a minor. Minor is just an addition on your degree, but it's not that useful. You can just keep doing courses that you like. It's not a necessity to have one, in my opinion.
Yeah, just to add on to that point, you know, many people, there are many minors in the HS department as well. So people just do it out of their interest.
Yeah. So minors are something that you just explore on the side. It's not like something that goes best with EP, because something that goes best with EP would be relevant right? Similar to EP. So you'll be doing those courses anyway as part of your curriculum. Electives that you choose would be like exploring outside of your fixed departments. Like free electives are from other departments, which may not be very related to what you usually study. Professional electives are what you do in your own core departments, that is electrical and physics department.
Arvind, like you could tell them about honors degree also, like.
Oh yeah, yeah. Yeah, that part wasn't there, right? Okay. Where is the documentation for that? Just searching for the part where it is written. Okay, I'll just give a brief introduction about that. So an honors degree is, yeah, so as he said, there's something called an honors degree as well, where you do 27, or how many more extra credits is it, if you know?
Yeah, shall I present my screen? I have the page open. I have a PDF. Yeah,
sure. That would be helpful.
So this one, right?
Yep. That is the last part, right? You opened it for EP, right?
Yeah. This is, wait. This is for engineering physics.
Yeah. Go down. Yep. So the last part, right, where you can see the last part is BTEC honors. So what you do is 433 is the number of credits you need to get your degree. And then 27 credits is extra. And if you do them, you get a honors in your degree. So honors, if you're going for higher further studies, it is somewhat useful when it comes to, you know, you can tell them that you did extra credits, you have a honors engineering physics degree. But in another way that it helps is that you get an extension in the number of credits you can take in a particular semester. Let's say you want to really explore some topic, but you're restricted by the number of credits that are allowed in a particular semester. So if you're an honors student, right, after your fifth sem, you have to make a claim saying that you want to do honors. So after that, the number of credits you can take in a particular semester increases for you, because you have to do 27 extra credits, right? And for such students, BTEC project is mandatory. What is BTEC project? It's an optional thing you can do. When it comes to engineering physics, last year you have the choice to do a BTEC thesis or three professional courses. The professional courses are just courses from electrical or physics department. So you can either choose, but if you're doing honors, you have to do a BTEC project. So you work with some faculty, some professors, along with them for a year on a particular paper or a thesis. You can get papers out, you can do proper research. So that is one nice way of exploring what you like. So honors is one option everyone has. Yes, the extra credits, right? Sorry, I forgot. The 27 elective credits, right? Last part, the last line. 27 elective credits should be taken from the 6th to the 8th semester and have to be from that department. They can't be outside. They have to be professional courses. That is from electrical or physics department. Yeah. Thank you for reminding me about honors. So now,
I just wanted to add this one point. So this honor thing is actually present in every department, almost every department in IIT Madras, because we might have missed it in the previous webinar. So I'm just making it clear.
Okay. Yeah. It's a similar structure in every department. It's not just for EP. And BTEC projects are compulsory in some, are optional in some courses, I think. But that is fine. It's not relevant to first year students, like just joining students, it's fine. Okay, so I'll share my screen again. Just let me know when my screen is visible.
Yeah, it's visible now.
Okay, thank you. So now I would go to the last section, which all of you will have a lot of questions about. What happens after graduation? So you can choose to have a job after graduating, or you can go for further studies, that is master's or PhD, or you can go for other UPSC or other entrance exams, whatever, based on whatever you like. So I would like to talk about only these two. campus placements, right? What happens is in your final year, you have played the placement season. That happens in December when you have all your interviews. But it starts, the process starts in the seventh semester where you apply to various companies on the portal. And based on what companies are open to you and what you like, you can apply to them. And there has been a trend of how companies open to CS, ELEC, and EP. It's like a, like there is a trend of companies which open for only these three. So EP is like sort of pegged with electrical and CS when it comes to some companies, which are very well sought after. And during your placements, you apply to these companies. Then you have a round of tests and interviews, and then you get a job. Then there is something called a PPO, which is nothing but pre-placement offer. So the way that works is, I talked about the internship, right? So the way you get it is there are some internship campus internship that happens in second year, and you get internships. So when you do your internship after second year and the company wants to hire you right off the internship, they offer you a PPO, that is called a pre-placement offer. So if you get bag a very good internship, that is, as I said, EP has a lot of opportunities within second year itself for internships, you can get a job out of your internship directly as well. So you don't, you need not sit for campus placements. Actually, the fact is, if you get a PPO, you're not, and accepted, you're not allowed to sit in campus placements. That is related to the job part. And I would discuss more about that when you guys ask the questions. And further studies, that is master's or PhD, mainly students go into like higher studies for physics, that is a PhD, master's of physics and PhD, electrical engineering MS, many people have done that. And then MS and CS is also very much viable. There is no restrictions. As long as you have done your courses, your projects, your internships related to this field, you are very much like, it's very much in your possibilities. And maths and statistics. So maths in EP, right? Every course you would keep doing maths, some sort of maths all around. And one good thing about the ELEC department in specifically in IIT Madras is that they offer a lot of mathematical courses as well. Right, it's not just restricted to the math department. Electrical department itself has a lot of math departments. So you can put in a lot of math and statistics related courses in the form of professional department electives as well. You need not use free electives to do maths or statistics related courses. So it is easy, and we already have a very good background in maths and statistics. So such further studies options are very much possible. Data science and analytics. So if you already have a good background in maths from EP, and you also build on top of that knowledge of ML, right? When these two are coupled with good internships or, you know, projects in the field of ML, you can very much go for an MS or a PhD in data science, analytics, ML, reinforcement learning, deep learning, all of them. So yeah, with that, I would like to conclude. Thank you. So now let's have questions about this topic. So all the questions in the beginning about the jobs, anything you can ask now. Is EP in IITM same as EP in old IITs in terms of placements? EP, wait, IITM is also an old IIT. Okay. Same as EP in old IITs like Guwahati in terms of, first of all, I think IITM itself is also an old IIT. And secondly, again, like, I don't have much knowledge about what research internships they get from IIT Guwahati, but curriculum-wise, you can check the differences from their portal. What is the path for choosing these streams after UG? What streams?
I guess you are showing a few streams, right, for higher studies. I guess he meant that.
Okay. These are streams. These are options like what you developed. Like if you develop an interest in, let's say, condensed matter physics, right? You would have worked with some professors on a project. Your BTech thesis could be based on that. So like you will develop, like whenever you do such intense courses, right, all throughout your curriculum, you will know whether you like it or not. And based on the amount of effort you put in, you would, that is the whole process of the university, right? Like when you are studying during your UG, you just keep doing courses and then you talk to the professor, do projects with them, figure things out. If you have a research mindset, then courses would be very interesting and will pique your mind. But if you're most interested in practical aspects, internships would be very helpful. So yeah, I mean, the whole process of studying in a college like IIT Madras would be very helpful when it comes to deciding. If a CS student has other questions. No, so CS students professional course is a course in the CS department. EP's professional course would be in the department of physics or electrical engineering. So engineering electives are, no, there's no engineering elective as such. There's just a type of course. But electives are just professional or free or HS. Your HS means humanities. So the H dot elective means humanities. Three humanities courses are compulsory. Does the automotive sector hire from EP? Yeah. So one thing I would like to clear is that engineering physics is very different from mechanical. The physics that you studied in JE, right, when it comes to the mechanics part, is more towards mechanical. Engineering physics is more towards like the actual physics for which people get Nobel Prize, like physics research. It is not automotive engineering. It's not related to that. Automotive engineering sector would look to mechanical engineering. Yeah, so they are constrained to make. Are all the companies that are open to CS open to EP? Not all of them. There would be some which are only open to CS. They are not even open to elect. Definitely there are some companies like that. But I would say that out of all the branches, elect and EP are the most favorable to be open to companies that are open to CS. For example, companies which are not open to mech. Yes, definitely there are companies which are open to CS, LEC, EP and not open to mech and chemical. Any companies like that. What is the average package that an EP graduate can expect? So that is a very misinformed question. An average package is not indicative of anything. You don't want to talk in terms of averages. You would rather want to talk about the kind of opportunities you get. Because in placements, the way it works is on day two, day three, day one, day two, day three companies have reasonably good salaries. You don't have to worry about that. What you have to worry about is what companies you would be looking out for and stuff like that. Average package is not indicative of anything. And I do not even know what that value would be.
Arvind, okay, could you just clarify them also about the crore packages and all? Like,
yeah, so a crore package that you read in a newspaper, right, is completely, you know, misleading. It is not at all like that. Not even crore, even the 50 lakh or 40 lakh salaries that people talk about, right? Microsoft, it is not at all that much. Like, you never see that kind of money. It is the CTC that they describe is based on a period of 4 years, based on a lot of stocks that they give you, which is based on how long do you stay there. So you might even, that salary might end up being just 20 lakhs at max over a year, right? So those are just misleading. Just news articles which creates hype for various universities, but it's not at all like that. So you don't need to worry about that. You will make a good salary. Just, you're from a good college. If you have reasonable work ethic and all that, you don't need to worry about like your salary. You will be able to eat and all that. Just a joke. But yeah, like you don't have to worry about packages as such. You should be more focused on the course and what you like as a subject. But yeah, EP is not at all like lagging behind in terms of opportunities, if that is your worry. So, is there some restriction on BTEC projects, like an EP student doesn't have to be in physics? Yeah, so my BTEC project was in math, statistics and like statistical learning, something like that, with some CS profs and one PCS prof and one electrical prof. So since I talked about, right, electrical department has a lot of math courses. So there are professors who do work on the statistical part of things. So you can do, as long as you have one professor from either physics or electrical department as your guide or who's registered as your guide, you can do whatever, work on any project you want, as long as you convince someone from the faculty to be a guide. So some people have even done BTEC projects related to management or finance. So you're not restricted, just based on your understanding with the professors. Does EP have physics-related areas? Have physics-related all areas of physics that we learned in, or is it strictly no? EP does, like as I said, it has an equal balance of equilibrium of both physics and electrical. But the physics that you will be studying is not necessarily like your JE mechanics and electrical. It is, that's what I said. You have to now actually understand what real physics is. The physics that you study in JE is more of an engineering related physics. But what you'll be studying in EP would be very much heavy in theoretical physics or, you know, application based physics. It is not like you just put in numbers, you can visualize some ball moving around and then you calculate the velocity. It's not at all like that. You would be dealing with energy states and certain differential equations or certain integrals, which are somewhat abstract and not very visual. Whereas in mechanical engineering, you would be dealing with similar maths when it comes to maths and physics. If we have interest in practical physics, then EP is a good option for us. Practical physics is again, you know, a very vague way of saying it. But practical physics could also be described as just engineering, you know. Like practical physics, if I can coin it as something like fluid dynamics or actual thermodynamics, where you are calculating certain things about an engine based on its specifications and stuff like that, that won't be there in EP. If you're talking about such engineering heavy-sided topics.
I guess, Ranish, we can wrap up with another one or two questions, right?
Yeah, it's been more than an hour. So, yep.
Sure. What kind of code jobs are open to an EP project, EP graduate? Okay. So, yeah, as I said in the PPT, your core jobs would mostly entail electrical engineering, CS related, that is software or ML related roles. And yeah, these are the two areas that are core. And then you can have non-core areas, which is analytics, management, consult, all those things are open. In context of atomic physics, I'm talking, if you have interest in practical physics, then AP is. Oh, yeah, definitely. In context of atomic physics and modern physics, definitely EP is a good option. You'll learn all this.
Okay, I guess we can wrap up. So, thank you, Aramin.
I think yeah. We can take some more questions. Like, we can wait for 3 more minutes.
Okay, sure.
Because this is the helpful part to them.
So. Yep. So, any more questions you guys can shoot?
Don't call me sir. I just graduated. Any other questions? Computational physics. Yeah, that's what you mean, right? Yes or no? Computational physics, right?
I guess yes.
Yes.
So definitely there are a lot of areas you can explore through engineering physics. There is a course about computational physics as well. It's a lab and it is very fundamental, but you learn a lot. And then you can explore from there on. Engineering design and engineering physics are as far as apart as they can be. They are very different. Do not even think they are common. Engineering design has a lot of topics. It's very interdisciplinary and very much engineering based, whereas engineering physics is more favorable to the research aspect of things, of sciences. Some of you are engineer ED, right? Someone was ED, I think, the cord that was talking to.
Yeah, Shihad was an ED.
But yeah, that's a different thing altogether. They're not at all common. I think we can take 2 more questions. If you guys don't have any, then it's fine. I'll just send this generic PPT to one of you and you guys can share it with the others.
Yeah, sure. We'll share it.
Okay, so I think there are no questions. So we can wrap it up, right?
Yeah.
Thank you, everyone.
Yeah, thank you, Aramin, for joining us. And thank you, everyone, for joining the session.
Yeah, I hope this webinar was useful.
Yeah, indeed, it was very informative and in detail.
Yeah, I mean, I like to do justice to this course because when I was joining it, nobody was there to help me out. So,
yeah, exactly. So that's why we thought of this initiative to actually, you know, enlighten the students, because, you know, once they join and see, that's when they get to know about all this.
And the common stigma about EP is that it's only research, you won't get a
industry,
but it's not true at all. It's not true at all.
I think this is eye opener as well. This thing gave a lot of information for the students to decide what they want to do.
Sure. Okay then. Thank you. Thank you for joining.
Yeah. Thank you so much.
Bye.